Do you hear me on the bridge?
Yeah, no, I just wondered if you see them again.
Not yet.
Searching for marine creatures is funny sometimes. We can be solely focused on searching for tuna when a pod of fin whales surprises us out of nowhere.
Beautiful.
Let's back up a bit though. When you think of Norway, you might think of Vikings, cold weather, maybe even trolls. But what about huge schools of migrating tuna? Or a shark or a sea star that glow in the deep? We're studying those and more on OceanXplorer in just 1 week. It takes a lot of work, so let's show you how we do it. First step, fly to Bergen, Norway. Next, let's board the OceanXplorer. Gather the gear, launch the drone, and now, just try to keep up. We have studies being conducted by land, by air, and of course, by sea. Let's start at the bottom of the ocean. This is our ROV. We're installing a new tool for its next dive. This instrument is a special syringe full of sea monkeys.
Sea monkeys? Interesting.
No, really. Sea monkeys are just a marketing term for a teeny tiny species of shrimp called brine shrimp. It'll be used to feed sea stars to hopefully entice them to glow. Meet our sea star experts, Henrik and Anders. They're highly focused, waiting to see if the sea stars glow for the sea monkeys. They're testing to see if the sea star's bioluminescence is to attract prey, ward off predators, or simply say hello to each other.
There's so much still to be done, so much still to understand, and so many exciting experiments to conduct, not least in the deep sea.
Now moving 1,000 meters closer to the surface, we have our submersibles too.
My name is Nico Straube and I'm a marine biologist, and we're here to study the bioluminescence of lantern sharks and try to film them in the wild for the first time.
Velvet-belly lantern sharks have been filmed down at depth before, but their bioluminescence has never been filmed in the ocean. So not only do we have to find a shark, we need to find one that decides to glow while the cameras are rolling. This takes a lot of patience.
What is that small one right there?
What's that?
The small one right there?
That is a lantern shark. That is one. Oh my god. It's coming. No. Stay.
That's
fantastic.
Okay, great.
These subsea vehicles give scientists the unique ability to study animals and their behaviors in their natural habitat. Researchers can see what they're studying at depth, often for the very first time. Now that we saw some sharks, Nika will be taking a look at the footage from our low-light cameras to see if they were able to capture the bioluminescence. While the subs and ROV have underwater covered, let's see what's been happening on land. We have a couple of smaller boats on board the OceanXplorer, which are called tenders, and we launch them to transport small groups of people to land and bring scuba divers to their dive sites.
My name is Chris Linderman. I'm a marine biogeochemical ecologist, and we're out here to study kelp.
Kelp and seaweed are abundant in the shallows, providing important habitat for lots of marine life and are a well-known carbon sink. But while we know macroalgae can capture lots of carbon, we're not sure how long it can hold on to it.
Throw it, say, there. Exactly, like that. Essentially, I count how many of these squares I do see a specific species in. In this case, it's only one type, so it's quite easy.
By sampling different species of macroalgae from different areas, it gives researchers a bigger picture of kelp and seaweed's impact on climate change.
It is estimated that kelp sequesters around about 620 million tons of CO2 equivalent per year. So we really need to basically get in the water and understand better how much of that carbon is indeed sequestered.
Yeah, you can eat that.
Yeah, you can eat basically, I mean...
It's crunchy.
All of them, if you want to.
It's good.
Yeah, it's not bad.
As fun as it's been on land, we still have more science happening. So it's time to head back to the vessel and hit the skies. From drones to helicopters, this unique perspective helps us locate many of the marine animals and phenomena that are harder to see when you're on the surface.
I'm Eivind Pixen. I'm a professor at the University of Bergen. I've been working on bluefin tuna for a while, mainly on their migrations and behavior and that kind of stuff. So this is a nice opportunity to try and capture their behavior on camera if we can.
Before taking out the helicopter, let's go to the highest place on the ship. It's the bridge.
Oh, that's tuna. That's bluefin tuna. Yeah. I saw the tail. I'm confident. Do you hear me on the bridge? Yeah, no, I just wondered if you see them again?
Not yet.
Okay. They are here somewhere. Not far. I can sense them.
And then, when we least expected it, we spotted something a bit larger than tuna.
He's there.
I
haven't
seen the whale yet.
Even though whales aren't what we are looking for, we can still learn about tuna from them.
Oh, there's several, huh? At least two.
Off the coast of Norway, there are currents that coincide, which causes nutrients and food to get stirred up. The whales are following this line, kind of like a food highway. The whales help show that there's plenty of food to support bluefin tuna migration as well.
Only a whale, as we call it now, when we are looking for tuna.
Oyvind still wants to see his tuna, so let's get the helicopter up.
We are flying the helicopter, looking for bluefin tuna. It's my first time in a helicopter, yes. And at this, in this very special location also, to try and actually see bluefin tuna from a helicopter. I'm very excited. I hope we find some. It's like going fishing. You never know if you'll find any. They come up here to search for mackerel. That's a very delicious fish for a bluefin tuna. But exactly how they cooperate around the mackerel schools, we don't know. There is so much, particularly about their behavior, that we don't know. We saw the tuna. That was beautiful. Really nice.
Oyvind finally got to see his tuna. And this is only a glimpse into what happens on mission. There is so much more research happening that we could show you, like these helmet jellyfish that are red to hide bioluminescent prey in their stomachs. Keep an eye on our channels to see more of that soon. But that's it for us in Norway. Join us on the next mission as we head 2,000 miles southwest to the Azores.